Greetings dear friends, I present to your attention the most common malfunctions and breakdowns that occur on the Audi Q7 4L. On heavy and powerful crossovers, the brakes are usually very vulnerable. A car with a gross weight of 2200 kg and a power of 300 horsepower, the braking system works in very harsh conditions, even with relatively active traffic and city traffic. What can we say about the cases when the driver really burns out? Everything is complicated by puddles on the roadway, omnipresent sand, traffic mode, traffic jam, gas to the floor, traffic jam, and sometimes by braking from a speed of over 200 on the highway. Brake discs with a diameter of 315 mm and 6 piston calipers already cope with this load to the limit. And therefore, for those who for some reason imagined themselves driving a racing car on a 2-ton crossover, among the options were off-brake metal to ceramic brakes, which were not afraid of such a load, although they didn't provide normal braking in an unheated form, not to mention the considerable price of such a solution. The service life of brake pads and discs is a very modest 20-30,000 km, and discs often run no longer than one set of pads. With step braking, careful and quiet movement, and extremely professional use of the brakes, the life of discs and pads increases two to three times. But most ordinary users of these cars have complaints about the resource of the brake system components. Accidental losses also include failures of ABS sensors, damage to the wiring of struts, air bellows casings, body level sensors, and rapidly aging brake fluid. Do not be surprised by non-original brake discs on a car with a mileage of up to 70-100,000. This is quite a typical case. Otherwise, there is nothing to complain about. The ABS works well, complaints about excessive releases in corners and on irregularities are rare. The fixing pin doesn't cut off because it simply doesn't have time to rust between disc changes, and the parking brake turned out to be quite reliable. The suspension of a larger crossover and even pretended to be sporty on wheels with duct tape too with a large resource should not differ even theoretically. In practice, it has hundreds of thousands of kilometers even in the city, and it's time to sort out the front suspension. It will require at least replacement of the silent blocks of the lower arm and the bolt joint of the upper one. And if there is an optional tuner, then the price of all problems increased by an order of magnitude and the fee of negligence. Old dryer, lack of weekly cleaning of pneumatic bellows and checking the wiring can make up a substantial part of the price of a car in the first years of production. It is not surprising that before restyling, Q7 often already have a collective form in the form of a spring suspension instead of pneumatics, or they regularly go to pump gas to pump up to gas stations since the pump cannot cope with leaks or has failed. According to some Q7 owners, the car handles better on springs, but pneumatics are excellent comfort with quite tolerable handling, so it justifies its price. In general, if you are looking for a cheaper Q7, then I recommend you to think about whether you will also pull the regular suspension cost. The steering was distinguished only by frequent rips of the rug and a small resource of the steering tips, especially in cars with V8 engines and low-profile tires. This is quite expected for urban operation, with frequent turns of the steering wheel to the stop and the rotation of the wheel in place. But the price of repairs is not even comparable to the prices of repairing suspensions and brakes, so the main risks in this case are not to recognize a rail leak and be left without power steering away from services. Without the help of the steering wheel is extremely heavy. This can simply lead to an accident. From this side, you cannot expect any special dirty tricks. The mechanical part of the transmission is very reliable, and the simplified design of the transfer case without the reduction gear makes it strongly. CV joints, cardan shafts, and gearboxes are made with a good margin and can withstand everything except a 6.0 diesel engine. If they are in yield with such a motor, then the shafts are literally twisted, the gearboxes are torn off from the subframes, and the teeth are cut off. This is not to mention the automatic transmission resource. Mechanical boxes, which are occasionally found with 3.6 engines and 3.0 diesel engines, do not cause any special questions, except that the resource of a 2-mass flywheel is limited to literally 100 to 1,500,000 mileage, and it costs a lot. And the clutch burns rather quickly due to the suboptimal selection of gear rations. The first gear is too long. With automatic transmission, everything is quite expected and standard. Before installing, the ICNTR60SN box was installed with diesel engines 3.0, 4.2 and with most of the gasoline with 8.4.2, the same one that can be found on the TLC200 and the platform KN and Touareg. It has rather conservative settings and, with a calm driving style, has an impressive resource for 250-300,000 km by modern standards. The joy is overshadowed by the capricious weld body of the gearbox, which is easily contaminated with wear products of the blocking linings of the gas turbine engine during active movement, which is typical for the style of use of such machines. In addition, the automatic transmission radiator is too small. The oil regularly overheats to temperatures above 120 degrees, which increases the chances of problems. In general, even a reliable automatic transmission cannot work a miracle, and most drivers have problems associated with twitching and delays in switching after a run of 100–120,000 km. Fortunately, the design of this automatic transmission allows, with minimal albeit not cheap repairs, to restore the gas turbine engine and the full operation of the unit without mechanical breakdowns. On machines with automatic transmission ZF6HP21, 6HP19, which were installed with engines 3.6 and 4.2, everything is noticeably more complicated. These automatic transmissions were one of the first where the gearbox control unit was moved inside the box itself, thus obtaining a unit called mechatronic, and at the same time they tried to reduce the working pressure to a minimum. It turned out ambiguous. The very aggressive use of the slip locking of the gas turbine engine, the sliding switching of the main clutches, the use of mainly linear solenoids allow to obtain impressive indicators of dynamics and economy. But the integrated design turned out to be very vulnerable to pollution and overheating, and with such strict algorithm of work, they simply cannot be avoided. In general, in addition to the wear and tear of mechatronics, the problems of which are many times more expensive than those of a conventional weld body and control system, there is a complete set of mechanical problems. The clutches wear out quickly due to the peculiarities of the algorithm, contamination and burning due to high temperatures, problems with oil pressure, wear of the gearbox bushings, damage to the drums and planetary gears appear. And of course, the resource of the gas turbine engine is small, in the region of hundreds of thousands. To its credit, this type of transmission can withstand the toughest starts and races for a while, even better than the older ICE transmission, but then comes to inevitable payback in the form of expensive repairs and frequent crashes. Moreover, in this case, 5 to 6 years is already a great age for the box. Often it is already ready to go for a major overhaul. With 6.0 engines, a reinforced version of this ZF6HP32 automatic transmission was also installed, and the amplifications was clearly not enough because contract units are in short supply. The motor successfully folds the box even at very low mileage, but the dynamics will be in the envy of gasoline sports cars. This cannot be taken away. On cars after 2011, the 8-speed automatic transmission ZF of the 8HP45 series with the start-stop function appeared. Even with such a ridiculous age by transmission standards, she managed to earn fame as an extremely unreliable, having a phenomenally small resource and, moreover, extremely expensive and difficult to repair. Although we must admit that the efficiency of the new 3.0 DFSI in combination with such a gearbox is impressive. The situation with the Audi Q7 engines is ambiguous. If you want a minimal of problems, take the diesel variants 3.0 TDI and 4.2 TDI. These are the most common. Quite average in all respects, the gasoline VR6 3.6 FSI for such a heavy car, even in the most powerful modification, was weak. Besides the difficulties with chains, the not very successful piston and power supply system didn't leave any chances for trouble-free operation. But against the background of a 4.2 FSI gasoline engines, 3.0 TFSI engine and problems with the cars with a 6.0 diesel engine, even this VR6 looks like a good one. There are a few common problems with motors. The cooling system on the QR was made with a margin, only on other gasoline engines the risk of leaks increased with the age due to cracked pipes, and diesel engines generally feel great. I have already talked about the problems of electrics, except that starters on diesel engines fail more often than usual, especially for some reason on restyled cars. The main Q7 engine is a series of 3.0 V6 diesels in different versions. A completely successful cast iron has an intricate timing chain, similar to the extremely unsuccessful gasoline 4.2, but at a lower oil temperature and lower operating speeds, it soars 1.5 times more. Difficulties with the injectors and the intake manifold, the presence of the unsuccessful modifications of the injection pump against the background of the rest of the cost of the car usually do not cause serious negativity. Moreover, the dynamics are more than decent for a car, and fuel consumption up to 14-15 liters per 100 can be considered outstanding. When buying, first of all, it is worth checking the fuel filters for chips. It is believed that cars after restyling with engines with the CASA index are prone to adversity, but in practice older engines also suffer from this small ailment. As a result of problems with the high-pressure fuel pump, the entire fuel system is polluted, and the replacement of the culprit itself would no longer help. The shavings from the tank will damage the next set of nozzles and the pump, a complex replacement of or cleaning is required here. The intake manifold on pre-styled cars is another source of problems, but since they manifest themselves with a mileage of up to 30,000-60,000, the chances of finding a car with these problems tend to zero. Well, unless purposefully looking for a car with minimum mileage from an owner who hasn't heard of recall campaigns. There are two turbines on these diesel engines. They have a longer resource. They can withstand more than 150,000 if you pour a good oil and do not drive through puddles after inhaling. Hot nails currently cracks when water gets in. Tubes for supplying oil and antifreeze require attention. Corrosion, high temperature, and dirt lead to leaks, and there is already close to the mold capital. Diesel 4.2 essentially differs from 3.0 a little. A resource is even higher, although taxes will also be higher. Unfortunately, the risk of the EGR system increased and cylinder head corrosion is more severe. Well, do not forget that automatic transmission with such an engine is very difficult. The resource is reduced by a good third, and the chances of problems with the mechanics of the box increase. The petrol VR6 3.6 is perhaps the most successful of the petrol engines. I have already mentioned the main difficulties with chains and light oil, but problems with carbon deposits, injectors, and fuel pumps are common for all FSI engines. The short resource of the ignition modules, oil leaks, and the motor's monstrous design of the cylinder head and intake are simply a consequence of the layout solutions, and they are not serious drawbacks. But a good resource of the piston group, low fuel consumption, maintainability of the structure, and ease of maintenance of Q7 with such an engine, even compared to diesel engines, are undoubted advantages. In some cases, a car with a gasoline 3.6 may be even cheaper to operate than a diesel one. The 4.2 FSI motors are a real failure. In addition to problems with power supply, there are also great chances of seizures of the allosteal piston group, difficulties with the tightness of the intake, with an old pump, with a lubrication, with timing chains, attachments, and a control system. The saddest thing is that money doesn't solve the problem. Even replacing the motor with the new one, you only reduce the chances of problem with low mileage. Happy owners of these cars with mileage up to 60 sometimes manage to replace two motors under warranty. Do you need it now, when the guarantee is no longer valid and the chances for a coolant extended guarantee are illusory? What if the cylinder block cracks? The only case when buying a Q7 with 4.2 FSI is justified is if the engine is already dying and the owner is offering a very good discount. After making sure that everything else is more or less in order, which is not always the case, you can buy a car on purpose for a swap, since with relatively minor alternations, an older gasoline V8 from the Touareg or Audi A8 will fit here. The all-new 3.0 TFSI immediately became famous. The manufacturer attributed the seizures of the piston group to an unsuccessful thermostat. Of course, lowering the operating temperature of the motor reduces the risk of detonation and the load of the aluminum steel coating, but apparently the problem was simply postponed until after the warranty. The engines were replaced, but most of the owners didn't even receive an updated piston group, only firmware and a thermostat. Apart from the risk of failure, the motor looks like a miracle of modern technology. Excellent traction and power, the fuel consumption is as low as that of diesel engines, although given the difficulties with the piston engine, it is better to feed the AI98 with a 3.0 TFSI. Honest information about the problems of the Audi Q7 4L is exhausted. If you know more or disagree with what you heard, I'm waiting for you in the comments.